Hello, sir.
Yeah, you are seeing my first slide, right?
It is not in a full screen mode.
Yeah, that I haven't made yet. That's okay. And I have, yeah, I will start my own video. Let's see if
Possible video.
I had closed the video. I will start again. Yeah.
Yes, Susmita, I think now it is okay.
Yes, sir.
So,
Is it okay now?
yeah,
yes.
it's okay.
No, actually, we have unmute all the participants so that
But you can
they.
note down the number. See?
Yeah, your number now I have noted down, so it
Yeah,
will
yeah.
be we understand. And you are given the permission. You can whenever you want, you can unmute, and specifically it is given.
Okay, thank you for your generosity.
Well, I see Professor Girish Kumar in a very happy mood, so things are fine, I presume. That
Always it is so, sir.
is nice.
Especially if I am seeing you, I'll be happy.
Well, I think there is an advantage as well as a disadvantage in these things.
Yeah.
We have to make the best use of the possibility. I could see a student of mine from Germany logging in. Ordinarily, she wouldn't have been able to do that, right?
Yeah.
So
Yeah.
there are advantages.
Yeah, that is the
Hello,
advantage.
hello, Ginny. How are you?
I think that
Well, she may
we.
be muted, so she may not be able to say anything. It's all right. I expect Professor Sri Kumar also to be coming in.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, sir, I am here.
Oh, good. I
Yeah,
didn't see you.
I am myself and Professor Pratapan are in the auditorium.
Oh, I see. Okay. Oh, you
Okay.
have several ways of doing this. Yeah. I think Kerala is, in that sense, advanced. A hybrid meeting is possible, and you allow people to come in. So that's nice. I'm still in my office. I thought it is easiest to give this from my office. So I thought instead of going anywhere else, this is easier.
Good evening, Professor Jamis. This is
Hello.
Pratapan.
Well, good to see you. It's
Oh, thank you. We are attending
not.
from the auditorium.
Yeah, I could see
So,
that those who are there physically, it's a lot easier
yeah.
to be a part of the Jubilee celebration. You know, I
Yes.
must say that after sending a title only, I realized that I should really not be spending so much of time on chemistry. And so even though I was tempted to change the title, I kept it as it is, but I changed the contents of the talk. I am going to talk about what CUSAT, according to me, should do to lead India, not just Kerala.
Wonderful.
So I would spend
That's great.
probably, 15 minutes on that, or maybe more,
Wonderful.
and then come to orbital engineering at the end, because orbital engineering is not so very important when I see things. I might try to see. Well, my office is not lit in the front from my point of view. So I think this is all right. Right, I can possibly switch off one light from the back.
Sir, our vice chancellor also joins.
Good evening, Professor Madhusudanan.
Good evening, sir.
good to see. I think the system is working well.
Yeah.
Your links are very stable. And I see people in the lecture hall as well. So that is nice. Kusat has always been a pioneer in many ways. I think it stays that way and it should lead even further.
Yes, that's what we're trying now.
Do you have now largely classes online, or there are regular?
Yeah, incidentally, we started regular classes today for the final year students.
I see. Okay, good. And this is, it would have been ideal if I were to be able to come there, but even otherwise, online, when yeah. I talk to an audience from Kerala, it's almost as though I am coming home. So there is that feeling that I am home already.
So, Professor Girish, Professor Srikumar, shall we start?
Yeah, we can.
Okay, sir. Then we can start. We all are.
Okay, we can start. No problem.
Okay. So, it is an honor and a privilege to welcome Professor Jamesh to our campus through our platform. Professor Jamesh is a friend and well-wisher of a university, especially Department of Chemistry. So we are fortunate to have a distinguished professor like Professor Jamesh with us this evening. As we know, this program is part of our Golden Jubilee celebration, National Science Lecture Series, as part of the World Jubilee celebration. So in this program, we are inviting very eminent scientists and academicians to our campus to interact with our students, research scholars, and faculty members. I don't think Professor Jamesh needs an elaborate introduction to this audience. We all know Professor Jamesh as a Padma Shri awardee and Shanti Swaroop Bhatnagar Prize winner, and so many other laurels to his credit. So I'm not elaborating all this in detail. We also know about his contributions in theoretical chemistry, or as is mentioned here, applied theoretical chemistry. That is what is mentioned here about the speaker. So I will not take much of your time. I request once again thanking Professor Jamesh for inviting our invitation and be present here. And I'm sure this will be a big, great experience for our students, research scholars, and faculty members to interact with Professor Jamesh this evening. Let me request Professor Girish Kumar to introduce the speaker and conduct the proceedings.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, hope I am audible.
Yes.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Madhusudanan, Pro Vice Chancellor, Professor Shankaran, most respected Professor Jamesh, Professor Srikumar, Head of the Department of Applied Chemistry, Dr. Susmita, convener of this program, my dear friends and students. USAT is celebrating its golden jubilee this year. As part of the celebrations, we are conducting a lecture series, a national lecture series in different subjects. When the Vice Chancellor and Pro Vice Chancellor asked my opinion on the talk in chemistry, the first name came in my mind is Professor Jemis. The reason being his eminence as an excellent researcher, as an excellent teacher, as an efficient institution builder, and above all, as a person who still believes in our tradition, the Kerala tradition. And he was telling, just before this, he was telling that I am feeling at home. Yeah, that is Professor Jemis. Professor Jemis, after getting his BSc from Calicut University, joined for his MSc at IIT Kanpur. He got his PhD in the year 1978 from Princeton University. He continued his research work as a research associate at Cornell University till 1980. He joined as a faculty member at Hyderabad Central University in the year 1980. At that time, accidentally, I was also there. I studied in Hyderabad University for 2 months for my MSc, then discontinued. So I met Professor Jemis first time there in Hyderabad. He became a professor at Hyderabad University during 1990. He was invited to join the Indian Institute of Science as a professor at the Department of Inorganic and Physical Chemistry in the year 2005. Professor Jemis served as the director of ICER Trivandrum during the period 2008 to 2013 on a 5-year deputation from IAS. Kerala in particular and the country in general is thankful to Professor Jemis for establishing this great institution at Trivandrum. Thank you, sir. He continued as a professor at IAS till his superannuation in 2017. And from 2017 onwards, he is serving as an honorary professor at the institute. His research aims to bring general understanding of structure, bonding, and reactions of molecules, clusters, and solids using quantum chemistry, transition metal organometallic reactions, structural chemistry of borains, boron equivalents of graphenes and fullerenes, etc., are his active areas of research. The Jemis MNO rule is very famous, and in the field of boron chemistry, these findings have got into inorganic chemistry textbooks all around the world. Professor Jemis is a fellow of Indian Academy of Science, Indian Science Academy, National Academy of Sciences, and Third World Academy of Sciences. As far as the awards are concerned, the list is reaching a number of 50. Right from National Science Talent Search Scholarship of NCERT in 1968 in his school ages, the list goes like INSA Young Scientist Award, Millennium Medal of CSIR, Andhra Pradesh Scientist Award, TWAS Prize in Chemistry, J.C. Bose National Fellowship, UGC Hari Om National Trust Awards, and then, of course, the prestigious Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize in the year 1994. Our great nation honored Professor Jemis with the Padma Shri Civilian Award in the year 2014. In the same year, he was awarded with Swadeshi Shastra Puraskaram for the best Malayali scientist. I am happy to say that I was the state secretary of Swadeshi Science Movement at that time. And I still remember Professor Jemis coming to the stage at Malayalam University, Tirur, wearing a traditional dhoti, Malayalide Munda. So simple a person. With great pleasure, respect, and proud, I invite Padma Shri Professor E.D. Jemis for the talk. Welcome, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for the kind words. I should thank all of you, Professor Madhusudanan, Professor Girish Kumar, and Professor Sri Kumar, the entire chemistry group at CUSAT for extending this invitation. You know, it is a rare privilege to be talking to you because I know how CUSAT has performed over the years. And it is not so easy to get an audience of this kind from Kerala anytime. And as I said earlier, it's almost like homecoming. And homecoming has a problem. You know, homecoming means one might leave the guards. And unguarded, one may say whatever one wants to say. In fact, after having given the title Orbital Engineering and Chemistry, I looked at the invitation again, and I was tempted to change the title, but then I felt I shouldn't. But I changed the talk, even though the title is the same. So I would spend a lot of time, at least first 15 minutes or maybe even more, talking about CUSAT from an outsider's point of view. CUSAT has led the nation, and it should continue to do so. So I would start in the following way. I will just give one or two slides as to how I plan to go further. You know, I would like to say that orbital engineering will come only in a part. So I would spend some time talking about CUSAT at 50, as though I am in Kerala, but I'm still outside CUSAT. And after that, I will talk about orbital engineering. But orbital engineering, you know, the topics that I want to cover, I have listed here. Large number of topics. The idea is that I would somehow get a connection between various things I have done and why I ended up doing these things. I ended up doing these things, and I will explain it in greater detail as we go along. I ended up doing these things for a larger problem, which is listed at the very end, structural chemistry of boron. But to get there, I had to do all of these. And I find that there is a common thread that is going through all of these manipulation of orbitals, molecular orbitals at different levels. And that's why I have given this topic. Now, let me come back to CUSAT at 50. You know, CUSAT at 50, we know many things of CUSAT at 50, even from the brochure. You know, it's an excellent university, and it is hard to believe that it is already 50 years. That is difficult. It was always thought of a young one. And in universities go, 50 years is nothing. You know, it is still a very young starting university. It was started as University of Cochin in 1971. And, you know, in the early 70s or late 60s was the time of happening in Kerala. We had the Calicut University established in 1968. And that was just after, you know, Kerala University was there for a while. Calicut came in. And then 3 years only it took to have the University of Cochin. And I was really attracted by this University of Cochin so much that in 1979, when I was looking for a job, I applied to Cochin University, Calicut University, and Kerala University. I did not get a job, but that is more because of the way in which I applied. I was totally unaware of how these things should be done. It is not the fault of the university system. I thought I should just write to university vice chancellors and they will make a decision and tell me something. But that's not the way it works. But what I would like to say is that it is a university that attracted enough attention because it is a university at that time with no affiliated colleges. There were not many institutions of that kind among state universities in India. One of the few, perhaps the only one in Kerala. I must be corrected if it is not right. But I was kind of perplexed when the name of the university was changed to Cochin University of Science and Technology in 1986. I was not following the happenings by then because I was away from 1971 and I had already joined the University of Hyderabad in 1980 and you know, it was a world of its own. I didn't really worry. But I was kind of curious why it was changed. When I look at the university, its departments, its outreach now in different areas, I wonder whether that was the best thing to have done. maybe University of Cochin was even better. Of course, Cochin University could still have the name CUSAT and have everything as it is. Now, I would like to say something about the lead that the university had given. That lead was that it is possible to somehow make the best university in a short period of time. You know, if you look at I think the Chancellor's Awards, the university has stood as number one several years in a row, right? Obviously, it is it is tough competition that is given to universities in Kerala and outside, considering many of the rankings. But I would like to bring a point that is not a problem of one university in India, but most universities, and how perhaps CUSAT could take a lead. Let me try to see what I have in mind. You know, we say that the level of innovation that a nation has will decide whether the nation is progressing well and whether it can rule the world, so to speak. And universities play a great role in this. Now, how do we really get to that? You know, we say, well, innovation usually is a result of questions that are asked at the right time on right topics. That means one has to learn to ask questions. And how do we learn to ask questions? Of course, people say, okay, you know, you have to be very intelligent. That's not true. I mean, genius will always ask questions. But to a large extent, the habit of questioning can be trained. And we will see that, questions, if you start training at an early stage, we tend to ask general questions. When I say early age is to be contrasted by, let's say, finishing stages of PhD. Right? If somebody is finishing PhD in organic synthesis, and we ask them, look, you know, you make a new project on some topic, what will the person suggest? It certainly will be in organic chemistry, maybe something left and right, but certainly not going to be in classical mechanics or history of early civilization, right? There is that problem. We specialized too early and we did not really look left and right. If you ask the same question to somebody who is just beginning PhD, first year of admission, perhaps at least the person will think of projects in physical or inorganic or organic chemistry. But if you go to the undergraduate student, especially in the first year, and this is where the problem begins, you know, he has or she has no choice but to say, I am in physics, I am in chemistry, I am in biology, I am in bioengineering, I am in bioinformatics, I am in commerce, I am in economics, I am in history, I am in something. That is not the way the world goes. That's only here. If you go further down in high school, let's say plus two is a good place to ask questions, except they are just too stressed. Most people do not have the time to ask questions. They are worried about answering anticipated questions in maybe a JEE or an EET or any other entrance exam. I mean, that's really something that we have to worry about. We don't have that breadth of knowledge even at that stage because we are just too much tired with this. We should have a broad knowledge. I mean, of course, in the beginning of civilization, everybody did everything and there was no division of knowledge. But then, as we expanded our own enterprise, there were natural sciences and humanities and everything else that people who used to do everything together, it became separated. In fact, there was an inevitability. You know, in the past, maybe Aristotle or Plato or Varahamihira would have done what would still be described as mathematics or economics. We had to make specializations. Now, specializations had its problems, right? And those problems, I now bring in from my perspective, and each of us have our perspectives. How do we get our perspectives? We get our perspectives from institutions and places that we have spent. So I get my perspective, and it is a very highly individualized one. But I would like to tell this, and I feel I could say whatever I want, because as I said in the beginning, I have come home. I am unguarded. I could say whatever I want, and I'm sure you all will not mind, even if it is utterly wrong. Now, my experience in different institutions tells me how we should proceed, because I have seen, when I was a PhD student, a mathematics major, an undergraduate student who came, who studied mathematics. He was not sure whether he should learn mathematics, but you know, it was interesting enough. And then he continued for PhD in mathematics at Oxford, all the while thinking that I have to do something more. And then he taught mathematics courses in Harvard just so that he will be having time to learn biology. And he learned biology, not just learned biology, he became the, you know, after 10 more years, he became the first director of the Broad Institute of Genomics. You know, Eric Lander, who had an undergraduate mathematics degree, a PhD in mathematics, right? The way one could go from one area to another, that is remarkable. I tell about another one. Well, you know, I want to say something more here. Now, I was hinting that we have BSc, BA, BCom, BTech. We have to decide and come there with that, whatever grade that has put us into a box. Once we are in BSc mathematics with physics and chemistry or physics and computer science, we don't have time to even take a few courses and see whether that's really what I want to do. I have written here a tiny step in ISERS, because you know they don't have humanities, social sciences, performing arts, fine arts, communication. They have a long way to go. But within the limited setup, they take students after plus two, and then they learn mathematics, physics, chemistry, biology, and whatever else that they could afford in the first 2 years. And then they decide whether they want to take mathematics or biology or physics and so on. What I would like to say is that UG programs in other parts of the world is not the way we have it. It is not the way we have it. That's really what I would like to stress. We have a compartmentalized undergraduate program, which has to be decided at the time of getting in based on whatever entrance exam. We always compare ourselves with great universities. We talk about MIT and Caltech and Stanford and Harvard and you know, everywhere else, Berkeley. I mean, but none of these universities have this. None of these universities have it. We can say, how did we get this? We got this because, you know, 150 years ago, the British were starting universities here, really speaking, colleges. And they changed perhaps over 100 years ago. We don't have a place where, you know, whether it is UK or other advanced countries, where you have to go in and say, you will be learning mathematics only with statistics and computer science. If you say, I want to learn mathematics with the music and history together, that's left to you, but not here. In fact, one of the biggest problems that I had encountered from plus two students who are bright and affluent are that, are we missing something by not going abroad for an undergraduate degree? And sometimes I'm very hard pressed to tell them, you will not be missing something, because you could go into one of the leading universities, take a few courses in many subjects, and then after one, two, or three semesters, decide what you would like to really do. You know, we have it wrong even in the IITs, because you have to take the JEE, and then you will select what subject you will get, what institution you will get, without worrying whether this is the subject that you want to stay on. It's very unfortunate. It is also unfortunate that top 2000 JEE rank holders all would like to do computer science. Statistically impossible. This is not how the world works. Why we got there? we just inherited and we didn't change. How do we change? Well, I give another example before I say change. You know, we don't consider, well, CUSAT is Cochin University of Science and Technology. Fortunately, it has many things more than science and technology, which is very good. Now we have, you know, I'm giving an example. History and history majors could be the sought after major in a university. In fact, again, I come back to the university that I am familiar with. 15% of the top SAT scorers who come to this university that I studied opted for history. Of course, there were 10 for computer science. There were many others for many things. But 15 of the higher rank, and universities worried about it. Not worried. They wanted to see what they do. So this university had looked at what has come of these history majors. They have really gone on to study maybe a PhD in history, maybe economics, maybe a law, maybe something else. But when they looked at the history of these history majors for 50 to 70 years, they found that many of them ended up as chief executive officers of multinational corporations. Now, why are they there? Because they learned history. Looking at history, they learned how things were 100 years ago, how it evolved, and they could think perhaps what could happen in the next 10, 20, 40, 50, or 100 years for an institution, right? And they were the bright ones that are going there. So there is a need for them, the visionaries who would understand everything and still specializes in history, right? We don't have it. But there is also the other way around. You know, I certainly talk about a historian in the sense that somebody who took up history as a major at Carnegie Mellon University and then decided to do a PhD, joined in my year in physics, a history major thinking that he should do physics. And why he didn't want to take physics after taking lots of courses in history, toward the end of the degree he thought, okay, he has to go to physics. Why? And he has an interesting answer. The answer is that he wanted to go back and see how far back he can go in history. There were limitations, maybe 10,000 years with difficulty, maybe 20,000, but he wanted to go to the beginning. He wanted to go to the beginning. History kind of forced him. If you want to go further, you have to go to physics. So he took up physics, wanted to go to the origin of the universe, right? He started string theory. And for the theories that he wanted to do, he had to develop the mathematics. And the mathematics that he developed for doing his physics, he got a Fields Medal. His name is familiar to the physics world, Edward Witten, who started string theory, started as a historian. But you see the possibility of shifting back and forth. This is what we need if we have to make a mark. And we have to really ask questions. Do not rush to generalizations. To ask questions, we cannot be put into boxes right at the beginning of an undergraduate education. We have to have ways of going back and forth. Now I ask, when I say ask questions and finish a degree, I want to just quote about a valedictorian. You know, a valedictorian is a person who is perhaps number one all-rounder in the university when they are graduating, you know, a graduating undergraduate student. And in the convocation, the valedictorian is given a chance to speak 3 minutes in that university. Normally, we don't allow a student to speak in a university in the convocation. This is the top ranker. He has 3 minutes. And in the year that I graduated with a PhD, this undergraduate who was giving the valedictory address gave something very interesting. He said, when he came to Princeton, he saw many squirrels there. And they were all black. So in his first year, he was sure all squirrels in Princeton are black. Second year, he thought probably so. Third year, he thought maybe some are not so black. But at the podium, standing at the podium, he said, look there, I see a squirrel. The only thing that I know about that squirrel is at this moment, on this side of that squirrel, it is black. Everything else is uncertain. 4 years of degree has taught him just that. One has to be questioning everything, right? This is important. One should not be boxed in so that one doesn't see left or right. And I say UG box specializations is an antithesis to this idea. No explorations will be attempted. How do we change it? I mean, how do we get there? We could have got there in any way. You know, I just give this quotation because I can't say it any better than Buckminster Fuller, after whom Fullerenes are named. He says this, whatever be the reason, we got where we got, but we shouldn't stay here. We got in here for whatever reasons, but we shouldn't stay. We should go further. And that is what is important. And CUSAT at 50 is an excellent institution. It does not have many affiliating colleges, which makes it a unique place where one can experiment. And the new education policy seems to be gearing and letting people do what they want. It is an opportunity for CUSAT to throw away the past and say from next year, we will have an open admission for everything. I can see total impractical idea that I'm putting in, but think about it. You know, no university in the world is doing what we are doing in India. Get a student and say, you will have admission in analytical chemistry or polymer chemistry, and that's it. Even for a 5-year program, this is not the way to go. It is an obligation, I say, because opportunity to lead, and an obligation because most institutions are not in a position to even think. And I think CUSAT has an opportunity to think at least in this way, to have a liberal arts, sciences, engineering, and technology UG program. If one is able to do this, this would be the first in the country. There are a few private universities trying this. That means admit students, but they don't have the variety that CUSAT has. They are just starting with either business management or computer science or large database processing or financial analytics, a very selected one. CUSAT has this advantage. So I'd say it is an opportunity and an obligation. Now, pardon me for saying these things. I felt I am at home and I could say what I want and you will not misunderstand me, because these are opportunities that come rarely. We have a time for change. The new education policy or national education policy is just trying to fix or trying to manage the change. It is not clear where the change should be even now. All that we know is we should change in such a way the innovation of the nation should increase. We should be able to lead the world. We should be the leaders in the world, right? So this is where I try to come back for a few minutes to the chemistry that I wanted to say. And even there, I will quickly go through what I want to say, topic by topic, and then later on mention why or how I reached there. Now, even this has a history. I will not normally say this outside Kerala. This history is that, I had a larger question that I once asked. I was just fortunate to ask a kind of impertinent question at the teacher in my first year BSc at the University College. Now, I must say, University College Trivandrum at that time was a college which did not have this liberal arts and sciences education, but it compensated for it in some way by having so-called university hostel for men. where everybody stayed. You know, the people who had mathematics, physics, chemistry, engineering, literature, Hindi, economics, history, everybody stayed there. And it was a melting pot. We are talking about late 60s, early 70s. And in my first year, that is 68, December or November, I asked a teacher who was teaching periodic table and the importance of carbon chemistry. I said, is there something similar for boron chemistry? And that question couldn't be answered by the teacher because the answer wasn't there of the type of question that I asked. I held that question with me for a long time through my master's and through my PhD. And a series of small questions related to this I had to get so that in 30 years, I could start getting the answers. Now, I have talked about the answers many times in CUSAT, the final answer or at least partial answers, but I haven't talked about how I got there. And I felt I will talk about how I got there by a few questions that are much more limited. And that series of questions can be categorized under orbital engineering. Right. So I would like to talk about now specific questions, and some of those questions are not presented here in the chronological order in which I got them, but in the way in which I could put it as a connection one after another. Even there is a story. And that story is that for submitting a PhD thesis, I had to submit not just the thesis, but three research proposals that are not connected with the thesis. And thesis is examined by the thesis board. So there was no reason to present it and defend it and so on. But the three research proposals had to be presented and defended. But the advantage of this presentation is that when I leave after PhD, I have three research proposals which are not of my supervisor, which are not in my thesis area. And I actually continued with the two of them because third was an experimental one and I didn't do any experiments. Now, first of this is presented here. I will list these topics one after another in the next 5 minutes and then come back to each of them. I said, look, we have a 1-2 rearrangement, you know, of vinyl cations, you know, 1-2 rearrangement. It goes through a least motion pathway. If I wanted to now change this, if I want to take this pathway and say that, okay, this group should start and it should go out of the plane of the screen and then go to the other side, is there a possibility? That is one question that I asked. It was a research proposal anyway of thesis. Then I asked another question. You know, I'm just leading these questions and say, I will come back to the answers. I was looking at cyclopropenoyl cation. You can make it neutral by taking a boron. If you replace two carbons by boron, then you need a bridging hydrogen so that you still have 2p, 2pi electrons. If you remove all the three, then you have three borons and two hydrogens bridging. This is neutral and aromatic system. It is flat. But if I add a proton here and make it a cation, suddenly it becomes non-planar. An interesting question that I asked, and I have an answer. When I got non-planar aromatic systems, I said, well, there may be other aromaticity which we haven't looked at. And we have so-called pseudo pi star aromaticity, right? Then I had asked, and this question is right from my research proposal submitted along with the PhD thesis. You know, the proposal was that we have carborains that are known in literature and the relative stability ordering was like this, the trans arrangement, you know, the carbons are above and below, that is the most stable one. You look at the next one, this is a trigonal pyramid, this is an octahedron. This also is most stable as a trans arrangement. But if you go to the pentagonal pyramid, suddenly this is the least stable. This was one of my research proposals, right? And I solved this and you know this was interesting. These are all steps that allowed me to go further to my larger goal. When I was looking at boron chemistry, I found that you know there are polyhedral borane dianions and they are not all stable. not all equally stable. And why are they different? That was another question. And why is this the most stable, right? I found another problem when I looked at the structures like this. You know, in some cases, the CH bond goes away from the cap. In some, it goes up. And similar observations in metal carbonyl. I was looking at organic structures of very heavy, very highly strained ones. You know, this is a cumulene. A cyclic cumulene is impossible to make. And it's the highest in energy in terms of strain, right? A three-membered cyclopropene is the next. And an acyclic system is best. So 3-2-1, the stability ordering here. But if I were to replace the CH2 by a bicyclopentadienyl titanium or zirconium, you find that these three are about the same, right? Something dramatic. How does that happen? And questions of this kind, you know, in carbon-carbon coupling and many others. So I would, you have C60. How do you fill C60? Is there a way that you can use an ideas connected with the molecular orbitals and see what are the best things possible? These were all the individual questions that I had, and I wanted to have at least partial answers to this, a few of them. It is not important that I go through all of them, but at least a few, two or three or four. And then I would like to come back to the issues that I raised in the beginning. And I would like to have a dialogue with as many of you as possible. And that's where I would like to spend more time than the specific solutions that I have, which of course are available in the literature already in most cases. We have published them. Okay, now here, you know, I have a molecular orbital picture, right? A bridging possibility exists when you take a group to the adjacent atom, and that is a bridged structure, right? A pi bridged. If it is a proton migrating, of course, a very easy three center two electron bond that you generate. But if you want to make it less stable and get it out, you know, if you can possibly bend these groups down, you essentially rehybridize it and you find that it is not overlapping well. But at the same time, the perpendicular pi bond is waiting, right? So if it starts in a cyclic system, the hydrogen may start in the plane, but by the time it reaches the middle, it has gone up, right? And nothing so, you know, profound, but this was one of the proposals. And, you know, the proposal was made in 77. I published this in 85 in University of Hyderabad, right? What I want to say is that it's not a bad idea to have proposals of one's own kind, projects which are independent of your thesis when you finish PhD. Let me go further. You know, this idea, you know, the idea that you can bend and get these orbitals to do things push me to see what is it like in bent bonds that are there in cyclopropenyl groups and the problem that I mentioned. How do I look at this? Well, some of you are familiar with cyclopropenyl cation and its Walsh orbitals. Those who are not familiar, you know, it's so easy to make. If you have three CH groups, you have three sp hybrid orbitals, you have a plus combination that is the most stable one. There is an antibonding one that has gone up. We have three p orbitals in the plane, right? The three p orbitals in the plane, right? These three p orbitals in the plane, you know, gives you a really a degenerate pair of orbitals below and a non-degenerate one which is totally antibonding that is very high in energy. In the same time, you have perpendicular 3p orbitals that gives you a plus combination like this, right? So we have this as a cyclopropenyl cation where the cation makes sure that we have filled only up to this point. Now we go through this exercise, right? This is what we just saw. We replace a boron, a carbon by a boron, it becomes neutral. We replace two borons and then we have to add an electron. That we do by adding an anion and at the same time protonating a bridge. Not easy to make, but it is known. You can do that with the B3H5, where all the three carbons are replaced. This is known. This is known. This one is known in the gas phase. So it's not as though they are unknown things. Now, what happens when you protonate? When you protonate, it has gone up like this. three bridging hydrogens have gone up, three terminal ones have gone down. Why is it so? The answer is not so very difficult to find. I would say we start with these and then add these three hydrogens. It is not so difficult to add these three hydrogens because three hydrogens will form three linear combinations. Two of these will easily find match. I will, you know, this was a student who wanted a fanciful animation, which I somehow don't want, but he did this. And the third one, you know, third one has the right symmetry, except these orbitals are directed to the middle and these are in the periphery. So it cannot interact. Now, the only way it can interact is if they come out and interact with the top part of or lower part of the pi MO, and that's what happens. If you take these hydrogens above, there is a greater stabilization. One can, of course, argue that is it a strain effect? It is not, because you look at the way the highest occupied molecular orbital, which was a pure pi MO, has stabilized by this process, right? It's nothing unusual. Somebody made it after 10 more years. We had published it in 92, and the example came only in 2011. Now, when one gets to cyclopropene cation, cyclopropane is not far off. And then cyclopropane, we felt, well, it is not aromatic. Is there any way that we can get a 2 pi aromaticity to this? A possibility is to compare again isoelectronic systems. We have a BH, a PF3, and a CO. CO and PF3 are known to be similar ligands. And the CO acts as a ligand because the pi star will have larger coefficient on the carbon. PF3 could act as a ligand because, again, the pi star, it is actually sigma star, but the sigma star of the pi symmetry, and we call it pseudo pi star, they could accept electrons. But if you have three of them, right, C3H3, there is no problem. Three of them, we have 2 pi MOs here. But if it is P3H9, you have a possibility that, you know, it is not stable because these are, you know, two antibonding orbitals and one bonding, and so it is not, and they are largely concentrated on the atoms at the terminal if it is hydrogen. But if it is fluorine, things change. If it is fluorine, we have the larger coefficients at the phosphorus. Then what happens is that we have a possibility of a plus combination of the pseudo pi star orbitals, which, you know, which appears like a pi MO, but it is vacant, but you can add two electrons. So if you have a P3 F9 2 minus, it should be stable. Now it is possible to speculate something. There is an attempt that is being made by an electron gun approach to make this compound. We do not know when it will be made. I mean, this was not published long time back. There is still time for it to be made. But this idea led us to worry about pseudo pi star orbitals again. And this time, through the process of a cyclopropane, let me show it again. You know, we have a cyclopropane, and I have replaced the cyclopropane 1CH2 group by a BH. Now, if I add two electrons, where does it go? It goes to the pseudo pi star orbitals of CH2. And CH2 pseudo pi star orbitals are so high in energy that you don't really get any stability. If you replace the carbon by silicon, you have slightly lower SIH pseudo pi star orbitals. But if you go further and say that you substitute this with a cyclic ligand on the silicon, and the cyclic ligand has a peculiar property. See, it is a CN, you know, NCN ligand. An NCN ligand, you know, its pi system is such that it is almost like allyl anion, except that there are two electrons from this nitrogen, two from this, and one from here. So there is an extra electron, you know, so to make this vacant, that extra electron actually could be the one that would be equivalent of this anionic charge. And if you have two such ligands, you are getting two electrons. So this should be stable, right? So we are having a C pseudo-Pi-star orbital here, a pseudo-Pi-star one there, and of course a pure P orbital on the boron. So this is not an all pseudo-Pi-star one, but there is a possibility. And it is not just a possibility. You know, it's just a year ago, we could get this experimentally made, and the structure is the way it is shown, and it is aromatic, right? So it is, you know, these are ideas that are strung together one after another, which essentially lets you go from one topic to another, and all of them are connected in some fashion, as I would, as it has started becoming obvious to some of you, but maybe more of you will see the connections. Well, this is a branch out from this earlier idea that if we have cyclopropyl cation, you know, here the C plus is not yet replaced by B. If you replace it by B, it is stable, but not so very stable, highly reactive, but a trigonal planar boron, you know, it has to be planar. But if you replace a CH2 by an SiH2, for the arguments that we made earlier, you know, this is not a minima, but we get a bent structure as a minima. You know, we are essentially breaking the rules that we know in standard chemistry. This can be done with aluminum and many other ways, but it is not anything so very complex. I would leave it to people who are really interested to see how this idea have come about. Now I come back to the second one of the research proposals that I had submitted in 1977, right? I published this a little earlier than the other proposal. See here, the problem is defined already. We have the idea that the trans arrangement with zero dipole moment would be the most stable one. It works well for trigonal bipyramid. It works for octahedron, but pentagonal bipyramid, it is just reversed. How do we understand this? Right, this is the problem. These two are the lowest energy one. This is not. I published this, you know, 2 years after I joined University of Hyderabad. Again, I stress this idea. It should be a good idea to keep a few research proposals from your own time, even while doing PhD in areas other than your own thesis, other than your research guide. Now here, I would say we have a cap and we have a two orbitals from the groups, and the ring is a little large. I have just used four membered ring. If the ring is large and if this orbitals of the cap are not as diffuse as one would like to have, these interactions are not going to be strong. If you had it here, it's almost as an ideal situation. The orbitals are of the right kind. If it is here, it's kind of other extreme, but it is not too bad still. This is a simple idea, and this simple idea has taken us far. Well, if the argument that I said is right, somebody can say, if I replace this carbon by silicon, which has much larger, more diffuse orbitals, will the relative stabilities reverse? Sure enough, it would. You know, it took us another 10 years to publish this, but yes, it does change. Now I come to yet another one. I posed this. Why is it that, you know, if you take all these polyhedral borane anions, dianions, one is the most stable one, then comes two. Earlier, I used to think that the largest anion, because it has more larger size, you can disperse the extra charge all over. That is the reason. But if that is the case, this should have been the second most. That is not, right? It is not the size. So let us take the middle two and see what can be done with it. And I'm sure the bright BSc student already would have got the answer from what I have said earlier. So I wouldn't really really spend much time giving an explanation, but just indicate the orbitals, and that is enough, right? I have a situation where the overlap is good. I have manipulated the ring size or the atom here so that the overlap is ideal, and I mean, not ideal, here it is ideal. And so that would be a good enough explanation. And we can say that this is not as good because the ring is too small. I have not changed the ring size, but you can see that it is a three-member ring that would be smaller. It comes to the other question then, why is B12 H12 2 minus the most stable one? Perhaps I explain this and then skip all the other separate questions that I had. You know, this question was very important because if you look at the structure of elemental boron, take any allotrope, any 3D allotrope, they are really made of B12. And so there is something unusual. Why is it still stable? Well, one can of course go back to organic chemistry and say that, it's as if you can put two pentagonal pyramids together, and pentagonal pyramids together is a good idea. I will skip this for the moment. If you consider pentagonal pyramids together, right? A pentagonal pyramid here, another pentagonal pyramid, staggering with each other, you get icosahedron. Now, if you look at this structure as we did just a little while ago, if you look at this structure, the terminal BH bonds are bent by about 24.2 degrees. If you take a solid icosahedron from the solid geometry itself, the angle that is there for the five-membered ring to subtend to a line that is going through the vertex and through the centroid is 26.6. This accidental coincidence of the two angles, very close to each other, that is why B12 H12 2 minus is the most stable polyhedron for boron chemistry. This is not so for aluminum or any other similar ones that you can think of. There's a lot of chemistry that can be discovered in this, and we have already spent 47 or 50 minutes. I could come back to this later and say that I would conclude the talk here and would have freewheeling discussions of whatever that we have said so far. And then if there are people interested, we'll come back to this. So I'm thinking I will try to stop at this stage and see if I could, let me see if I can just go to, we'll come back to this later on if people have the interest. But I will formally stop at this stage. I thank Professor Madhusudanan and Kusat, Professor Girish Kumar, Professor C. Kumar, Susmita, all of you here, and my own students who have worked over the years to get these ideas into action. Normally, most of my students are so very imaginative. I suggest something and then they are on their own, really wildly going into ideas that I never even dreamt out when I told them. And I thank you for the kind attention. I will be ready here now to discuss. And at the end of it, if there are topics that we can go back to in chemistry itself, I will be very glad to go back. But I would like to have a greater, I would like to see a greater role for Kusat to lead India. And that is my theme, really. My own research is insignificant in relation to that. So let us, I'm open to now questions by anybody. And I am at home, so I am free, unguarded.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Yes. In fact, I would request the Honorable Vice Chancellor to comment, because I made statements that are made from a very, very simplistic point of view, but from a distance, without knowing the ground realities.
Yes, thank you very much for your illuminating talk, Professor Jamesh, especially for your feel for Kusat. And of course, we heard quite interesting suggestions from Professor Jamesh. Really thought-provoking. I'm sure we should consider all these aspects. We have been talking about these things, how to change, and we need to change. That is, everybody has agreed on that. There's no doubt on that. We have to change for better when we stand at the, you know, at our Golden Jubilee. So everybody has agreed on that. But how to go about it? That was an important question. You have given a very good, you know, thought-provoking ideas to us. And I'm sure our students and faculty members will definitely think about all these things. Of course, you know, to give students a wider perspective so that they, you know, think in a much wider way, understand things, and, you know, can move on to new things without, you know, confining in a very small area. So we have to, you know, make their understanding wider so that when whatever they do in future, it can be much more meaningful. We definitely need to incorporate, you know, those aspects in our system. So we will definitely think about it whichever way possible to introduce these aspects in our system. So it was a very, very valuable suggestion, and we will definitely take it that way. Chemistry part, I do not know. So I will leave it to our chemistry people. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
In fact, I would like the
Professor Jamesh.
Yes, please.
I am Sri Kumar.
Yes.
What you have suggested is a good idea of a combination of liberal arts, science, engineering, technology, and so on in a single stream of undergraduate education. I think only after you have left Hyderabad University, the College of Integrated Studies was started there, no?
Yes, it was talked about for a long time, but even that integrated studies is in a limited way. The reason I say is, since I am at home, I tell you how strongly students feel about it.
Yeah.
And I tell you from a very, very close personal experience. You know, my daughter studied BSc and MSc here and joined at IISc for PhD. But, you know, she was given a topic that she didn't like, so she went for PhD outside. And she was a teaching assistant in an average university in the US. After 2 months of being a teaching assistant, after having seen how undergraduate education system works there, she called me on the phone and said, "You shouldn't have done this." And I didn't know what she was talking about. She said, "You had an education elsewhere. You knew how that system is. You should have sent me as an undergraduate student to take that education, to have that advantage. You didn't think that far. Don't tell me you didn't have money. You should have taken a loan." You know, this is a very strong statement coming from one's own daughter. What does it mean? It means that someone who had done a BSc, and she didn't do bad, she did BSc and MSc and got admission for PhD program at IISc in biology. But what I want to say is, when I said a liberal arts, sciences, engineering, technology, UG program, what I mean is that a university should offer courses in all of these areas. Students join and then they take courses, whatever they like, first semester, second semester. If somebody, after seeing whatever courses that you're giving in, thinks that I will go into history instead of mathematics, he has an option, she has an option. And then you can put restrictions. If you're going into history, you should have 4 courses in in the science stream or engineering stream on course and so on you can put. But one goes through an education like rest of the world going through an education. We are not doing that. Even those experience this like me are not able to enforce. So he put the phone saying that, okay, my case is over. Go do something to change it in the country. And she was upset, so upset. And that I cannot tell in the public. I can do it at home when I talk to my people. So I'm talking about what we do not know. Or when we go abroad and we know, but we forget conveniently. But a young person does not forget so quickly. And that is why I so strongly feel CUSAT has an opportunity. There are very few affiliated colleges that CUSAT has to worry about. Most state universities have affiliated colleges. I will come to affiliated colleges later. What can be done with them? Because I have observed that and see. The problem is we are hesitant. We will blame UGC. There is no reason to blame UGC. UGC never have put such strong controls if one is willing to do this. And we can do it now. It is not going to be a slow change. I hesitate to use the word that is often used for fast change. I do not want to use that word, but I would say we need a sudden change. It will not happen in a slow way because we have teachers, students, parents all objecting to it because we do not know enough. Because it is going to cost time and energy. And there is a certain level of turmoil in the beginning. What is the alternative? The alternative is to keep the 150-year-old system that we have got when the people who gave it to us changed it 100 years ago. And we are hesitating. This, I can tell you the result of it. When I was going for PhD, another professor from IIT Kanpur who had done PhD in the same institution, I went and asked him, how is it like going to a new place for PhD after an MSc from IIT Kanpur? He told me then that you will do very well in the courses. You will be number one easily. But he also said, an average student out there will do much better in research than you do later on. Because they had grown up asking questions, even as undergraduates. I have done BSc mathematics as subsidiaries, physics and mathematics as subsidiaries and chemistry, right? I did not study maths, physics, chemistry, biology the way I liked, or history or economics. While all my other colleagues who came for doing PhD there had a general education, they of course majored in chemistry ultimately. And they do better in research than me, even if I stood first in the courses without any question. And this is true even now. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. There is an urgency. 150 years is a long time to wait. It will not happen if we are not willing to take risk. It is a lot safer to keep going the way we are going. But then we will have the same question. Only the ones who are smart and who are very wealthy, they will go and study undergraduate studies abroad where the system is more open. So there is, I would like to say the same thing is true of colleges. We were told about autonomy. Nobody was willing to take autonomy. They say, oh, question papers will come from some other place. Why should it come from some other place? At least there are two colleges under Osmania University became fully autonomous. They made their questions, they graded and they set their grades. Only the university gave the degree. Even that they should change. Here we think the exams have to be using question papers set by somebody else. Because we don't trust our teachers. How does that trust come back when it comes to NIT? An engineering college next to it will have to get the question paper from somebody else. NIT doesn't have to. It's just a question of how we keep things in mind. We need to change, and somebody has to take the lead. And I felt CUSAT has a greater chance to take the lead. And if it does, it is number one in the country to do that among government-funded universities, state or central. Even IIT Bombay hasn't succeeded. They are just beginning to say that some courses can be taken because our system did not permit them to admit 1,500 undergraduates for engineering and allow them to take, because the system has told them, you all have to take BTech engineering in, I mean, computer science. So I'm sounding a little too excited. I don't do this, but I do this when I'm talking to my people. But I would like to hear further. You know, I interrupted Professor Srikumar in the middle.
Yes, sir. I was trying to make the point. You know, when you have a school of liberal arts and sciences, you know, all these different faculties will be there, and we can have an integrated approach for the undergraduate course. That will be giving courses on humanities and subjects of humanities, especially economics, history, political science, and also courses on chemistry, physics, mathematics, biology, etc. But unfortunately, in CUSAT, we don't have any humanities departments, and only the applied economics department is here, and other history or political science or all those things are not here in this department, in this university. But they are strong in other universities like Kerala or Calicut. No, they have good departments, political science, economics, and history. No, they have. But they have not thought about any such systems. But they are burdened with the affiliated colleges also. What you have said is absolutely right. They are burdened with the affiliated colleges, and therefore they cannot make a change. We can do that, but still the problem is we don't have good humanities departments. And I have seen the almost similar experiment in Hyderabad University. No, they are integrated courses. No, they are catering to all the different branches. They offer courses on economics, history, political science, the languages also. You know, all those things are there, and the students can choose the different courses. And to a certain extent, they are amalgamating the different streams of courses in their integrated program, because they have a strong.
I think my point is different. My point is that even in University of Hyderabad, a student joins an integrated program in chemistry or physics or mathematics. He or she does not join to earn a degree, even a 5-year degree. He cannot or she cannot join the university for a degree and then look around and see what he would or she would like to study. It is different from the specializations that is being offered by University of Hyderabad in an integrated way. They have possibilities to take one or two courses outside the main. What I have described is what happens in rest of the world. And that is, I go as an undergraduate student to a university, and I look at their whatever courses that they have, whether it is mathematics, physics, chemistry, biology, history, economics, performing arts, fine arts, communication, it doesn't matter. And then I select, depending on my taste, a few courses and see, is that what I like to stay on? And then change. You know, even IITs don't allow you to do this. If you are in computer science, you are in computer science. In University of Hyderabad, you cannot change after joining in physics that you want to go actually in music. No. What I want to say is that is not the way the world is. And somehow we know it. Anybody who has gone and stayed a few years or even a 6 months in a university abroad and observed it carefully knows that most universities are different. But we do not do this. In CUSAT, I agree that we do not have many things. But let us list all the things that we have and say that we take students to study there, right? They can take courses in any one of these. And then with time, a semester, 2 semesters, 3 semesters, they can slowly figure out where they would like to go. And the next 2 years, we are going to have 4-year degrees soon, right? Next 2 years, they can concentrate on what they want to do. This doesn't require, if you don't have history or if you don't have economics, it doesn't matter. At least only those two they will miss. But they can learn everything else. I mean, they can taste everything else and then decide rather than getting into applied polymer chemistry at the beginning after plus two. After plus two, one should have at least 3 or 4 semesters of, you know, what they, in some Western countries, they say freshman and sophomore years, 2 or 4 semesters to take courses and then decide. In our case, of course, one should blame the school, which has stopped already all questioning powers so that students don't even think. Parents have no idea. Because in a developing country, there is always the worry, will I get a job? But the truth is, in the last 10 years history, if we find people who are working, willing to work hard, the chances of getting job is pretty good. Any job, if one can take, right? So the problem that is attached to a category of job will go away once we get better. But if you do not do this, we will continue to do what we have been doing for 150 years. At some point, some university has to boldly say that, yes, we change. We have a 4-year degree here, right? There is an upper limit on the number of students you can take, and that upper limit is a notional one. You know, I remember MSc, I forget now whether it is botany or zoology or whatever in Kerala University. You know, they take 12 students. And by the time the first year is over, they have 7 students or 8 students or 10 students. While people go to other universities outside the state. This has been going on for 40 years in a master's program. If there is no space for increasing the number from 12 for MSc to 24, in 40 years, there is something wrong. There is no will, perhaps. Now, I am putting ideas because CUSAT has done well in 50 years, and 50 years is a time to take decisions and make bold changes. I seem to be too articulate. I said when I come home, that is what happens. I don't speak like this, I can tell you anywhere else. So pardon me for being at home.
Sir, actually, you know, we are trying with the integrated program here. As you said, for the first 4 semesters, the students can take all the subjects, chemistry, physics, mathematics, biology, English, Hindi or Malayalam, and those languages are there. And after 4 semesters, they will decide to go for either physics or chemistry or biology or mathematics or statistics and so on. That freedom is given. And only after the 4 semesters, they will decide.
I mean, they can go to English literature, for example.
We don't have an English department for this.
What is the department other than science you have?
We have one applied economics department. Then Hindi department is there.
So a master's in Hindi is available?
That's not available. So far, mm-hmm. It is not available.
I mean, it's a 4-year degree or 5-year degree?
Five-year degree.
I think the degree should be 4 years as the new education policy says. Hopefully, it will become across the country. That's what I was told. I do not know. Eventually, in the next 10 years, the degree will be 4 years.
Yeah, hopefully. When the Delhi University started the 4-year degree they had to stop, you know, after 1 or 2 years.
Because the teachers didn't want it and some students didn't want it. And students didn't want it because they didn't know better. Like as I said, and those who know better usually keep quiet, as my daughter accuses me of. I'm just, continuing a conversation amongst friends. So I'm just telling that there is no harm in changing. If a 5-year degree has not taken more people,
we will try,
maybe
sir.
A 4-year degree.
Yeah, we will try. No, at least if it is a 5-year degree, we will try to give chances to the students to take English literature or Hindi or allied subjects. No, if at least we should have the minimum number of faculty members in those departments. If that is there, we can very, very easily think of these things. No problem at all. And when the Center for Integrated Studies has been designed in such a way that these things can happen. Yeah, only yes. After 3 years have passed since we started this course, and we are trying to evolve.
Yeah, in fact, I was looking at the website and looked at in detail what is going on in CUSAT. In fact, I spent more time on that than preparing my talk, because I'm so unfamiliar with this. See, I left Kerala in 71. Imagine that. I left in 71, and I had a brief stay of 5 years in Kerala, but that was a 24/7 job of a different kind. I didn't have time to look left or right. It was such a tough job because there was no moment to breathe. So I am totally ignorant of the current reality, but I have arguments with my relatives who teach in colleges. In fact, I have some of my close relations teaching in colleges, and I'm so very angry with them because, many of these good colleges have UGC scale. And, in terms of what we all earn, whether it is University of Hyderabad or Indian Institute of Science or a UGC scale college, differences are there, but not very large. And yet, my relative teachers, close relations, they take it as a typical 9-to-5 job and not a tabasya that one should see in IISc. And I always argue with them. And they said, you don't know anything. And now they avoid me. I mean, I'm just telling, there is a cultural change that is there in colleges that is needed. But CUSAT is not like that. I see publications coming in, people are working hard. So it's a lot easier. Anyway, these are, my thoughts, which may not have much value, but I thought I would say it anyway.
All the participants also can ask any questions because they can unmute their mic, and if they want to ask any questions, they can go ahead.
I think I would like to add or ask something. I'm Gini, and I was Professor Janice's student in 2019, and I was working in his lab. I would really like to thank.
Can you be a little louder, please? It's not very clear.
Can you hear me now?
Speak louder.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So I would like to say that I was Professor Janice's student in 2019. I was with him. And I'm totally in sync with his ideas. So whatever Professor Janice suggested, it is totally required in India, because when you go out of India and see the culture abroad, I'm right now doing my postdoc in Germany, it is much different. It is much liberating, and it also gives you freedom to think a lot outside the conventional lines, which is very much required. And I would also say, not just for the students, it's nice to have something interdisciplinary so that they just not think about science in a closed box way. They think of science as an open system, having the ideas of arts, maths, economics, everything together. So that is what I totally agree is missing. And I have seen all the education systems in India. I did my college from a general college in a general BSc from university, master's from university level setup. Then I went on to ISER, which is another kind of very good institute, which gives you more opportunity to have interdisciplinary topics, much more better than college and university, and then on to this international level of education system. So I would say that not only for students, for people who want to become teachers or who want to be into education system, it is very much required for them as well to have the flexibility and incorporate the new ideas which they gather throughout their journey. So this is also kind of, if you suppose go in a university or a college level teaching where actual students need a lot of exposure apart from these big institutions, teachers also do not, I think, have the flexibility to teach in a certain way. We have to follow a certain rules because there is a fixed curriculum and which has been taught since years, and the same curriculum has been going on. So I think this is absolutely required, and I totally agree with the thoughts of Professor Janice that this is really required in our education system now. Thank you.
Well, thank you for your comments.
But I would just like to ask that you are into the education system. How long do you think it can take to implement this system actually in our country?
Are you asking me?
Yes, that you are that you are at this level. Like,
well, I have no powers. I would have immediately put the question on to the Vice Chancellor. But before I do that, let me tell you one thing. If you are going to take time, it will not be done. Because we have taken 150 years and we haven't done it. It will be done suddenly, then it might be done, because people think too much about it. And there will be hundreds of things that you can find which will be standing in front. And yet, it's like asking me, the MHRD asked me, saying that, okay, you are made the director of ISER Trivandrum, right? They said this in June and told me that, yes, you will start classes on August 15th, right? Yeah. I was in Bangalore, first employee of an institution, and there was no other data. And strangely enough, on August 17th, classes started. And classes started in Trivandrum, right? So it was 2 months. So when one is hard pressed, things will happen. It is true. I wouldn't like to go through that experience again, because I probably became maybe 15 years older in 5 years. That's a different matter. But it was possible. The governments, departments, state government, everybody helped in the process, of course. But it was possible to have classes started on August 17th, even though the institution formally started in March with a board of governors chairman signing a memorandum of understanding with somebody or a society formed. So in that sense, it can be changed quickly. If we say that we will solve all the issues first and then do this, it will not happen, because it hasn't happened in 150 years. And we will continue this way. And our best minds, because some of them are super smart, they go and do things. But even our not so super smart, even our average can do good things, like rest of the world is doing. Because the power to ask questions that lead to innovation, to a large extent, it can be trained to individuals who are not inherently geniuses. Well, I would ask the respected Vice Chancellor to say, you know, how difficult and how impossible it is to change anything.
Of course, we have set patterns of doing a business. We have to definitely break this. Then only things will move. It's not that our faculty members or students, the society at large, the parents are very, very important component in that. Of course, the leadership has to come from us because they don't know many things. So we have to lead. That is very important. We have to put the ideas across and make them accept at least some of these ideas. Then only this will be possible. Because our society side, parents also, they also wanted, you know, very streamlined kind of things. So it's not easy for them to think something, you know, something little this way or that way. It's very difficult for them also. We cannot blame them. But that is the way we are, because we have actually people, competing for too little things. Too many people competing for too little things. So that is very, very important, because that is the way. So we don't take risk. We tend to move on the set path. So that is very important. But to break this, definitely it is a big task. But it is definitely possible. I think for an institution like us, definitely it is possible to think at least. Even that is not possible in some other places.
That's right. Yeah. So I fully agree that we have, you know, this is the problem of a developing country, because we do not have enough. But what astonishes me is that even those people who are affluent and can take a chance with their child's education to leave the kid the way he wants by guiding him only to good institutions, even they do not do this. See, I can see poor people, lower strata of society, where the job of the boy or girl quickly is absolutely essential to survive. I can see that. But even those who are well off, so to speak, could wait for a few more years, they did not do this. In fact, the number of questions that I had to answer from my immediate relations for agreeing to my daughter saying in the seventh class, I will not go for any coaching class. I will not write any entrance exam for medicine or engineering because I do not want to be a doctor or an engineer. And I had even my own brothers telling me, you're spoiling the career of a good student. So that is the society that is there. And you can imagine who others would be talking about, right? So we have to somehow make a beginning. Where do we begin? At least making an opportunity available so that those parents who are saying, okay, I don't think it will make such a big difference if my son or daughter do not get a job in the end of the fourth year, if he or she continues for two or three more years of experience of various kinds, thinking about other things, right?
Yeah. Here we have definitely have the opportunity to, you know, definitely think about it. Many other places, it may not be possible. We definitely have an opportunity. We definitely can make changes.
I think so. I think, yes. You see, Kerala has also the right atmosphere, I feel. For example, IIT Palakkad has done something remarkable in their MSc program in chemistry. You know, this is a different subject, but I tell you, MSc program in chemistry is taught across the country with courses in organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry, physical chemistry, analytical chemistry, and so on. But IIT Palakkad has started an MSc program in chemistry, which will carry all these things, but They teach structure, synthesis, reactions, properties, without dividing molecules into organic and inorganic, because they are all the same. The idea has been around, but this is the university that has done, institution that has done it for the first time in the country. So there are firsts that we can do. This started only last year. They haven't got the first batch out. It is the current second year, right? Of course, they are making sure that in the process, they don't leave out things. But there is a unified way of thinking of chemistry as a whole. That is the other extreme. Here we are talking about polymer chemistry, analytical chemistry, and everything else, specialized degrees. There, the MSc program after BSc, people join there and they would learn an integrated approach to learn all of chemistry. Even the IITs do not have it. Other IITs, even senior IITs don't have it, because it's an effort to do it. Fortunately, when they were beginning and they were young people, they were willing to think and make this happen.
Any other participants would like to ask any questions?
Susmita, I have just one comment. Susmita?
Yes, sir, please.
Can I make a comment?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Professor Jamis, I hope you won't take my words too seriously, but I would like to say that you are talking like a true academician and as a very bad business person. So here education is more about business. That's precisely the problem that we are facing. But then, as you said, there should be a paradigm shift at one point or another.
Just one more minute.
The major problem we are facing is, you know, catch them young should be the policy. But that doesn't work out here. Actually, what a student should do is decide after class 10, not after they come to the university. After class 10, they are divided into 3 or 4 streams. In some of the streams, they don't have to study mathematics at all. And when they come here to study chemistry, that will be becoming almost impossible. So my way of looking at it is that there should be only one program in the school where everything is taught. Once that is being done, we can have a very integrated program at the university level. Otherwise, how we are going to integrate a student who has done his third group, no mathematics, no science? He comes to college, university, we are offering him a degree course. How we are going to teach the mathematics or science? They haven't done anything after class 10. So that is where I think the first change should come. And we should have an entrance examination in the lines of SAT, not the stupid, JEE that we have. That has to be done away with. The major problem this country is facing is IITs and JEE. Can we do away with that? Things will change. Instead of that, let's have something like SAT.
Yeah, see, you said it is business. Is CUSAT doing business?
Yes, we have a business school.
That is a branch of study, but is CUSAT doing business?
Yeah, we have actually a business cell now.
Yeah, those are smaller events. You started by saying it is all business. That is why I was saying, you know, that is true of private institutions. See, my worry is that there are some private institutions beginning with this idea of a liberal arts and sciences degree. Now, the problem is that if they succeed, then they will replicate a Harvard here, and only the people who can pay a $60,000 tuition fee can go in India. That is where the difference is. CUSAT has the opportunity to do it for others, people who do not have that $60,000 to pay every year. See, private universities are just beginning. They haven't succeeded yet because, you know, they are looking now at the lucrative, as you said, lucrative degrees. But some of them are thinking about in a larger way that we will make good institutions at exorbitant inputs.
Sir, may I comment?
Sure.
I am Binita, working in Government College, Pattambi.
Yes.
I have two things. First one is, as you said first about the education, as Pradhaban said, after 10th, we are moving to a specific stream. then coming to degree courses. But still, I think if we cannot change in the plus two level, it is at the degree level also, it is possible. If COSAT is having the power to do that, it will become fine. Because I have done my pre-degree course in second group and did chemistry with mathematics and physics as subsidiaries. So,
yes. I fully agree with you. In fact, today I had an email from a person who had just completed a PhD, taking a long time from Germany in ecology. And he was in the first batch of ISA Trivandrum. And he came without mathematics.
For 2 years.
I think I couldn't hear. Vinita.
I don't have any touch to mathematics. But
yeah, exactly.
So it is possible.
Exactly, it is possible. So this student came in and he had to take mathematics, physics, chemistry, and biology compulsorily in the first 2 years. And we had to, of course, put extra effort with the mathematics teacher, spending more time with him. And he now is so happy that he learned mathematics because his research in ecology, he is doing most statistical work, essentially getting a relationship between bioinformatics, genomics, and distribution of species. He said, if he hadn't done the mathematics compulsorily, he would have been nowhere in this area. What you said is true. The idea of school education should change. But you know, I have tried to say this to people who are involved. They are not as receptive as the enlightened faculty of CUSAT. You know, the teachers are, you know, they have problems that are so far away from what we are talking about when we tell about these things. But a change is needed, otherwise we will continue endlessly. And the professor will continue to tell that, yes, you will go and get first in all the courses that you take, but you will not be the most innovative person in the department despite topping all the courses. That ability to innovate comes from asking questions on different ways and different backgrounds. Yes, Vinita.
Sorry, sir, I left in between.
Yeah.
I am talking about the government policy now to allow students to take part-time job in between their courses. But in CUSAT, we have almost just like a residential school because hostel facility is there, everything is there. But to attract caliber students with caliber, we have to offer some scholarship or something like that. And we have to attract students because in our place, actually the parents are not doing the leading role because they are from very poor family. So the students are deciding what to take. But sometimes they are forced to prefer job. Very bright students are here, but still only very few are coming to ending with PhD. And still they may be searching for job due to the restrictions here, have to stay here like that. But if CUSAT initiates some promises like this, students will come, things will change definitely. So your ideas,
yeah, executable. Patambi has a master's program, right?
Yes, research also we are doing.
Yes, there is a student from there in chemistry.
Yes, Priya Kumari CP was your student. Yes, sir.
She had problems, but you know, the problems are solved just when she wrote a CSIR JRF and got an ET, and suddenly life changed. She didn't have any money otherwise.
Yes,
and
yes,
life
she
changed
escaped.
To such a level. So it is not as though it is not possible. But the thing is that Priya Kumari is just an exception. Somebody who could push the system.
An average person
should have an accessibility of learning many things in a setup. I have no idea how the autonomy considerations are there for individual colleges in Kerala. But you know, autonomy, I would say autonomy should be given to everybody because it puts responsibility on them. In the absence of autonomy, people have all kinds of excuses if things don't work. If autonomy is given, the responsibility increases tenfold.
Definitely, sir.
And that people are not willing to take. Then whom do we blame? I don't know.
The decision makers are sometimes different. That's the way.
I don't know. Maybe, I have had a chance to make decisions only about one institution, and there the decisions are taken quickly because there was no time to think about things. So you decide and follow. But an institution that has spent 50 years and done well, if a decision is taken or if a suggestion is made that we want to change like this, chances of the government, the education department, UGC, everybody else accepting that is very high because CUSAT has done well. If a third-rate university is saying this, people will not take it very seriously. That is why I said there is an opportunity and an obligation.
Yes, sir. My second question is that, which is the good software to work with graphene, theoretical studies? Totally different.
Well, I think, this question I need to answer at different levels. It depends on how much money you have to buy a software and whether you are willing to buy or use a rather clumsy but free software. And
Gaussian here, sir. Only Gaussian is here.
Oh, Gaussian is able to do that. Gaussian can be used.
Okay, sir. I am just the beginner for theoretical studies.
Yeah. No, Gaussian can be used, certainly.
Okay.
Because Gaussian has the option now, earlier it didn't have. Now it has option to study solids.
Okay,
sir. 1, 2, 3 dimensions.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Susmita, I think questions are over. You can.
Yes, sir. So probably, if since there is no other questions, and I would like to first of all thank Professor Jemis for taking out his time and agreeing for coming to this talk and initiating a discussion which is well needed and a very different kind of discussions than we had on this matter. So thank you, sir, for doing this. I would like to thank our Vice Chancellor, Professor K.N. Madhusudanan, sir, and because he has spent time throughout the program and participated in this. Thank you, sir. I thank Professor Girish Kumar, Dean, Faculty of Science, to also participate in this program, and our faculty members from our department. Professor Sri Kumar, Professor Pratapan, and others to join this and make it a success. And last, because of the participations and the active discussions among the participants, also have made a very good impact on us to think how we are going to go about in future with our education system, which is very important. So with this, I hope that we all had a good time and we can conclude the sessions, and thank you all for their supports, and we can leave the meeting. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Susmita, and my apologies for not talking about chemistry as much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming back home and shaking all of us. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Jemis. We were
Thank you.
No?
Okay. So I'm so glad that you all stayed on. That was
yeah,
nice.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, definitely we will discuss it at the first opportunity.